So anyway, I'm Brendan.
Hi, Brendan.
I work at the Great Plains Institute. We're 15 years old, and our mission is to transform our energy system in order to address climate change. So we do that in several ways. One of them is by doing policy development and advocacy, typically through a consensus-based processes. We try to, we're the group that tries to metaphorically lock everybody in the room and try to get them to agree on a path forward. So we do a lot of work with industry, with utilities, with clean energy businesses, with the environmental community. We also do actual community scale work to deploy energy technologies and practices, and then we do a lot of analysis and develop decision making tools for policy leaders. I work on other things, but I'm here talking about the bioeconomy today, the whole universe of things that you can make from plants, which we certainly consider within the realm of renewable, of what constitutes renewable. We have a lot of history in that area, doing a whole bunch of different activities, including promoting specific projects. We've done some international delegations to go show people best practices in Europe. We have a long history of working with the Midwestern Governors Association to inform their energy policy. And then I'm going to talk a little bit about the Bioeconomy Coalition of Minnesota today. Minnesota has a lot of biomass. What do I mean by biomass? It's sort of plant material other than grain from crops or oil seeds. If you were looking at an agricultural material, it would be the stalk of the corn, it would be switchgrass or native grasses, it would be forestry materials. The green is forestry, the orange is agricultural residues. We have a lot in the state, a lot of resource. And on the forestry side, we have a declining forest products industry, severely declining forest products industry, and risk that you're actually going to lose multi-generational logging families and lose the ability to actually have people in the forest to do some of the management that's needed. There's a balance there, but there's a lot of people concerned that the timber harvest is so far down that you start to lose the capacity to manage the forest properly. I'm going to start by talking about specific opportunities for what does the bioeconomy mean for Minnesota? What are some specific things we can do, types of projects that we could develop in the state? So I'm going to start with advanced biofuels. Many of you are familiar with conventional biofuels. Corn ethanol, starch-based ethanol derived from sugar, and biodiesel from oil, typically soybean oil. What's an advanced biofuel? It's sort of the next generation of biofuel development. One prominent example would be, instead of making ethanol from corn grain, we could make ethanol from corn stalks, the part that is not competing with food commodity markets. You could also, if you have that technology in place, you could make ethanol from prairie grasses and a whole variety of other materials. The other part of this is making something other than ethanol. So there's some companies looking at making things like biobutanol instead of ethanol. It's a longer chain ethanol. It blends at a higher level with gasoline. We could have biomass-based butanol as well. Anything that's an advanced biofuel has a very specific definition in federal statute. It must meet a 50% greenhouse gas reduction threshold on a life cycle basis. It's sort of you're locking in a degree of greenhouse gas reduction much deeper than what you get from current technology, although you do still get some reduction from the conventional biofuels. And this is just a complicated life cycle assessment chart. The red bar is what you should pay attention to. Gasoline, carbon emissions. Corn ethanol, you're doing a little better. Sugarcane ethanol, you're doing a little better. But if you make ethanol out of corn stalks, switchgrass, or miscanthus, that's just a perennial grass, you can get to almost zero net greenhouse gas emissions or even potentially negative. Here's a project that's happening right now. I take questions.
What was the main reason for that drop?
That's a great question.
It's a significant drop.
Here's one of the reasons. So And this gets a little technical, but biomass is made up of, it has a sugar component, which is cellulose and hemicellulose, and you have lignin, which is sort of this glue that holds all the sugars together. It's really hard to break this up. This is the technological challenge, is busting up that biomass into sugars that you can ferment just like any other sugar. You're able to use the lignin, though, as your heat source, instead of using fossil fuels, which is what an ethanol, typical ethanol plant would use natural gas for process heat. You eliminate that fossil input. The other part of it is these calculations factor in something called indirect land use change, which is basically, it's the food versus fuel issue. If you take corn out of commodity markets and put it into ethanol, it has to be grown somewhere else. Through complicated modeling, they figure out that there is some greenhouse gas emissions associated with that, because you're clearing forests somewhere else to plant corn. That is not the case with corn stalks, and not the case to a very great extent with things like native grasses. Those are the main reasons.
Okay. It's not personally not in school, but trying to ask if you eat.
Yeah.
And that common corn stalk, does that mean corn stalks?
Corn stalks, yep.
And then switchgrass and grass, and then what's the third common thing?
Miscanthus is a perennial grass that there have been efforts to. I mean, the thing with something like miscanthus is, you know, you might get, if you harvest corn stalks, you might get 2 tons on an acre of land. This native grass, you might get 10 tons. So you get a lot more per acre.
I can understand that it takes a lot of fuel to make ethanol, so that less fuel consumed than those using these other forms like prairie grass.
You know, there are energy inputs into corn ethanol. There's sort of this perception out there that you have more energy going in than you get out. That's not really true. That hasn't been true for a long time. It might have been true for some of the early plants in the 80s. You know, you probably get energy return on investment in the 2 range or higher. But you know, cellulosic ethanol is going to have a higher energy return on investment as well. Yeah.
Is the forest situation due to the fact there aren't any trees, or there isn't any market for paper?
There are a lot of trees. The big issues are just the changing international market for paper. A lot of pulp and paper plants have shut down. So, you know, our highest timber harvest was over 4 million cords. It's around 2.5 now. And so you are having a lot of families leaving the business that have been in it for multiple generations. And I would really argue, I've spent a lot of time up there. There's a lot of people in DNR and other circles that are concerned about the ability to, you know, just forests can benefit from some disturbance, just like a prairie ecosystem. Getting in and doing some removal can be helpful.
So using that for energy then would be a solution to that?
Potentially, yeah. Yep, definitely. So, yeah. So, this is life cycle assessment. I shouldn't have put this one up. Let's see. The blue is pump to wheels. The gray is well to pump. So when you're doing full life cycle, you're calculating the emissions all the way from the field all the way through burning the stuff in your car. So you have emissions that occur in the car when you burn the fuel, and then you have sort of the upstream emissions in the process. So pump to wheels is like after you put ethanol in your car and burn it, there's emissions as it burns. And then you have, biogenic, there's this big part under the zero, because you're absorbing CO2 when you grow a plant, right? You're sucking it out of the air. It comes out again when you burn the fuel in your car. So this red number is net. It's, you subtract this from this. So I'm going to talk about one kind of cool biofuel project. This thing called cellulosic ethanol, which would be ethanol from biomass, from stalks, from wood. It's been a really huge R&D project going on for 20 or 30 years or more. The Department of Energy has put billions of dollars into it. And a lot of people have been skeptical that it's ever going to arrive. You know, it's been called the phantom fuel. But there are several projects opening up this year. Let me, I don't have my map. I'll show you a map later, but there are projects opening up this year. There's two in Iowa. One of them's Poet DSM. One of them is run by a company called DuPont. You maybe heard of. Another one's Abengoa, which is a Spanish ethanol producer. They're building a plant in Kansas. I've been to them twice. They are real. They're mechanically complete and starting to operate this year. It's a really exciting time. Poet, again, they are going to use corn stalks, and they're actually co-locating. They're right next to a regular ethanol plant. So you take biomass, you convert it into sugars, and then they're going to have a power plant there, which will power both the cellulose plant and the regular ethanol plant. So they're making the regular ethanol plant more energy efficient as well. They're going to have the largest anaerobic digester in the United States associated with that plant. It's sort of like the old saw about being a hog farmer and using everything but the oink. It's an incredibly efficient plant. This is a huge pile of corn stalks. They've spent the last 5 years figuring out their whole supply infrastructure to bring the stuff into the plant. This is it under construction. This is a few months ago. It's complete now. So I want to stay on track here. So I'm going to kind of leave it at that. There's other exciting things happening in the state. There's both companies at the kind of startup level. There's a couple of actually ethanol plants that are being retrofitted. There's an ethanol plant that got bought by a company called Gevo. They're going to start producing butanol instead of ethanol. It's an innovative thing. If they want to be an advanced biofuel, they're going to have to do some things to reduce their carbon footprint. That's a good thing. Butanol can be blended at higher levels with gasoline than ethanol. You really can only blend ethanol at either 10 or 15%. Butanol can be blended at a higher level so you can get more into the fuel supply. That's actually pretty important because gasoline demand is going downhill. So if you're limited as a percentage of gasoline, your renewable fuel market's going to slowly decline over time. Renewable chemicals is a whole other part of the equation. Now, what's a renewable chemical? You got your same feedstocks, sugar-based feedstocks, biomass, waste materials, which I'll talk more about later, whole variety of processes, here's your black box, but you get all the sort of other things that we make from oil out of biomass materials, plastics, PVC, 3D printing. Actually, there's a company called NatureWorks, which makes a corn-based plastic. They're located out in Minnetonka. They're the leading plastic for 3D printing. Kind of cool. Household chemicals, specialty chemicals, basically everything. You think about an oil refinery. About 3 to 5% by volume of that barrel of crude turns into things other than energy. Plastics, chemicals, materials. Okay, that's that little branch of the tree. That's your volume. All this stuff is energy. Well, chemicals are 40% of the value of the revenue into that refinery. So 5% of the output, 40% of the revenue. When we operate ethanol plants, we're not capturing the potential for the big value stream. So A, they're up against the petrol refinery complex that's been in place for since World War II, has all their costs all amortized out. They can run them really cheap. They're at scale, and they're not getting all the value that those companies are getting out of those refineries. So fortunately, Minnesota has the largest cluster in the world of startup renewable chemical companies. Super exciting. We've had more than $200 million in venture capital investment come into the state in the last several years, $200 million, over 200 patents filed. We've got really, really cool stuff happening. I've talked to a lot of people in these plants who, I've been in Houston for my whole career. I'm from Minnesota, but I'm a chemical engineer, and there aren't any jobs here. They're getting the chance to move back to Minnesota and be part of this startup industry. It's really exciting. There's little bits here and there, but Twin Cities is a big cluster. Challenge is this. What we have a lot of right now is we have lab coat jobs in the Twin Cities metro area. We have R&D. Great jobs, right? But what these companies need to figure out how to do is scale up and actually do production and use biomass materials, agriculture and forestry materials to actually make these products. That will spread the wealth throughout the state, not just metro area high-paying tech jobs, but manufacturing, high-paying manufacturing jobs in greater Minnesota. Now, we've had three Minnesota companies announce manufacturing plants in the last 3 years. Two of them, one of them was in Thailand, one of them was in Canada, one of them was in Minnesota. Why did the two companies build elsewhere? Because those jurisdictions offered better incentives for doing industrial scale manufacturing. We're working hard to try to make Minnesota a better place to do these projects. I will say one of them, good news last year, a company called Sagetis, announced a $100 million plant up in Hoyt Lake, Minnesota. It'll be a sugar-based project. They're going to make a whole variety of materials. But you know, a big emphasis of a lot of these companies is substituting for things made from petroleum that people are trying to get rid of. Highly toxic chemicals of human health concern. For people who are involved in this area, phthalates is a plasticizer that goes in a lot of flexible plastics. It's in almost everything. You think about fake leather, couches, garments, other materials, PVC. It's an endocrine, suspected endocrine disruptor. BPA is another one. I'm not the public health guy, so I can't go too deep into that, but a big part of the reason these companies exist is they're creating substitutes for things that are, in California and Minnesota and Europe, they're trying to phase out. So there's this whole other value proposition for the general public about, it's easy to, it's hard to pass bills that phase things out if you don't have a good alternative. We're trying to create alternatives to make it easier to get rid of the bad things. We create more good things. Why are they in Hoyt Lakes, Minnesota? Who's heard of the IRRRB? Iron Range Resource Rehabilitation Board. It's revenue from taconite mining intended to create other economic activities for the day that will come when we run out of taconite, right? They are able to make investments in attracting businesses. They've made some good bets. Not all of them have been good bets, but they do have the ability to make public investment in attracting facilities. The rest of the state doesn't have that. So if you don't happen to be in the 6-county taconite relief area, you can't do this. But this is exciting, and we could be retrofitting ethanol plants, forest products facilities all over the state with these kind of high-value opportunities. Take it back down to the ground level, biomass thermal energy. It's the oldest thing we've been doing with biomass. We've been doing it for years. It's tempting to say it's kind of a dumb technology. It's cavemen sitting around a campfire, but actually there's some cool opportunities for the state. There's some new technology, and I think it is a big opportunity. I think you know what I mean when I say biomass thermal. It's burning biomass. It's your wood stove. It's district energy in St. Paul. You can use virtually any type of biomass for thermal energy. Why does this matter? Well, thermal energy is pretty significant, a third of U.S. energy consumption. We have a lot of biomass, and there's a lot of niche opportunities. So one of the big things that's going on, we talked about how Minnesota has a declining forest products industry and a surplus of wood. Those areas happen to be in the parts of the state that tend to be served by propane. We had this little thing last winter where propane prices spiked. We kind of ran out of propane. The economic proposition for substituting for propane with biomass is really fantastic. It's okay if you're in a natural gas served area. It's still break even and works out. But if you're on propane or fuel oil, it's a really good, the economics work great. You can get this whole value chain, right? You can keep loggers in business. You've got the processing part of it. Actually, some of the cleanest burning wood stoves are pellet stoves, very low air emissions. You need a pellet mill for that. There's a lot of interest up north in building pellet mills, but we don't have enough pellet demand yet. It's kind of chicken and egg. So we're interested in trying to create some more demand for pellets to try to get some pellet mills. But fuel handling, distribution, and then a big part of it is actually making your stoves. So you can do home scale units. There's a lot of cool stuff. Actually, there's that place up on Franklin right next to the Seward Co-op that has really cool modern wood stoves, really clean burning modern wood stoves. You can do commercial scale. We're talking schools, hospitals, and there's a lot of projects that are being proposed up in northeastern Minnesota right now at community colleges. The city of Grand Marais is looking at doing a project, actually a district heating project, which would, you know, put in a steam loop and connect to a bunch of buildings. It's a neat opportunity. You can do industrial scale, combine heat and power and district heating systems, so you can really scale this at different levels. There's a lot of opportunities. I just wanted to emphasize the emissions part of it. Modern biomass stove technology is really clean burning. This is PM 2.5 particulate, fine particulates, much, much lower than your old technology, you know, old pre-1990 wood stove, your fireplace. If you put in a modern biomass stove in your house, you won't smell it walking by your house on the sidewalk. Yeah.
I don't know if it's true. It seemed to me that if you had a wood-burning stove, your homeowner's insurance wouldn't insure you. Is that true or not?
I don't know the answer to that. But I
Because I was actually having a wood-burning stove once upon a time.
Yeah.
Long, but that's 2 years.
Okay.
Hopefully pressure would change so they wouldn't. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So changing gears again, this is the last topic area, but anaerobic digestion. Who knows what anaerobic digestion is? So anaerobic digestion, you take, again, we've got our biomass materials. This is going to be more focused on waste materials, though. Agricultural wastes from food processing, wastewater treatment, huge opportunity there. Manure. You put it in some kind of vessel, put a lid on it so oxygen can't get in, and you get a certain type of bug in there that turns biomass into methane. Methane is the main constituent in natural gas. You can do a whole bunch of things with that methane. You also get some digested solids that you can do nice things with as well. But what can you do? So you get biogas. Sort of the stereotypical biodigester, I think what a lot of people think of when they think of a digester is a little small on-farm project. You've got a dairy farm, they put in a digester to process their manure, which is a great thing to do. You know, they take care of a lot of the odor problem, they get some energy out of it. The problem is these small-scale units, the economics aren't that great. The gas, you get gas that you can't really afford to clean up, so you've got hydrogen sulfide and things. They try to run it through a genset and produce electricity, but the hydrogen sulfide in the gas follows up your genset and it wears out very quickly, making your costs escalate even further. You've got somebody who really should be running their dairy farm trying to be an engineer on the side and run a digester that has some problems. This is the reputation. We've had some good projects like this in the state. They've had a lot of challenges to overcome. And so people have this perception like, yeah, biogas is this little niche thing. We're trying to change the whole paradigm on biogas. These little on-farm systems, they're too small, so they don't get economics of scale. They're using manure, which is, you know, the cows really, they've extracted a lot of the energy out of it already. There's higher energy feedstocks that you could mix the manure with. And then finally, electricity is your lowest value market. When the biogas could be used to produce transportation fuel, it could go right into the natural gas grid. It can produce heat. You can any energy need can be satisfied by methane. You can, you know, again, upgrade the pipeline quality. So a lot of applications for this technology. Wastewater treatment is a huge one. There actually are a lot of digesters at wastewater treatment plants. A lot of them are just flaring off the gas, which is an okay thing to do. You're turning methane, which is a much higher greenhouse gas intensive gas than the CO2, but we're also missing the opportunity to displace fossil fuels with that gas. Landfill gas, there's some cool things happening there. You do have some landfills actually around the country that collect gas and not just flare it off, but actually compress it and put it in vehicles. So you get some city fleets powered by your landfill. That's not such a bad deal. Of course, we'd rather see them catch the organics before they go in there, and then you don't need the landfill anymore. And there's a lot of sort of agri-industrial opportunities all over the state. This is one, actually, this gets into fuels again. Biogas from anaerobic digestion is approved by EPA as an advanced biofuel. You can compress that methane and use it in a compressed natural gas vehicle. It is very low greenhouse gas intensity. This is actually the biggest thing right now in the so-called, in one of the pools in the renewable fuel standard. This is the highest produced amount of cellulose, so-called cellulosic biofuels. It's helping to meet the mandate, federal mandates. Again, anaerobic digestion fits into biofuels. The Project Liberty cellulosic ethanol plant has the largest digester in the country. Some of what comes off of the ethanol production process can go into a digester, produce gas, and eliminate the need for natural gas in your plant.
How much area for feedstock does that need?
Oh, that's a good question. I'd have to do a little back of the envelope calculation. I could do it for you after. I'm not going to try to do it in my head right now. Yeah.
And then this is probably another difficult question to answer. What is the volume of production during anaerobic digestion? Is it, obviously it's based on a lot of things, but is it produced mass quantities very quickly, or is it
you've got a life cycle
to the process?
You've got kind of a residence time. It's not a continuous system, it's a batch system, so you put a bunch of material in a vat, and it really varies a lot by the technology. I mean, I think it could be anywhere from days to weeks. It really depends on the material and the technology and the volumes.
Another question?
Yeah.
You said manure, I gather that's from farm animals?
Yep, yep. Could be human, wastewater treatment.
What about pet manure? We cannot compost that in the city and home compost.
Yeah. Sure.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. Well, and not everybody even has the opportunity to do curbside composting yet. So,
this
anaerobic digestion pairs up really well with composting. In a lot of anaerobic digestion systems, you actually have to have a composting step after the stuff comes out of the digester. So this is not in any way in competition. We've done a great job as a metro area in starting to build up our composting infrastructure and get some industrial composting. These projects would pair up really well with those, you know. So, you still get the same material out. You put it in a digester, you still get a bunch of solids out, just like you would out of a composting system. You still do a further composting step. The difference is you have the opportunity to capture the methane instead of emitting it. So. And I do believe that, by doing that two-step process, you would eliminate a lot of the pathogens in animal waste. Yeah. So we did a little sort of analysis on Minnesota's biogas resource, looking at crop residues, dedicated energy crops, wastewater treatment, landfills, municipal waste, manure. We found that Minnesota could produce enough biogas per gallon equivalent terms to exceed current ethanol production, all from waste materials. And there's ethanol consumption. So, I mean, it's a big opportunity. So how do we capture all these opportunities? I'm one of the organizers of a group called the Bioeconomy Coalition of Minnesota. And it's the mission of that group to do a lot more of all these things in Minnesota that I've talked about. We have a really broad membership in the group. It includes the forest products industry, the environmental community. It includes agriculture. I think this is one of the few groups where you might see Conservation Minnesota sitting right next to the Minnesota Corn Growers. But we've been all over the state talking about how this is a statewide opportunity. This is an opportunity for agriculture. This is an opportunity for forestry. Opportunity in the metro area. It's an opportunity for greener chemicals. It's an opportunity for cleaner fuels and energy. So it's really statewide. And we have done, one of the questions we get asked a lot is, we are advocating for the state to spend some money. What's the return on that investment? I'll talk in a minute what specific policies we're advocating, but we do advocate for something that would cost money. We actually signed non-disclosure agreements with 7 companies that are considering projects in Minnesota, collected a bunch of data, handed it over to the University of Minnesota Extension. They did a big study and handed us aggregated numbers for state impact. So if we were able to build 14 plants, the cost of incentives, I'll talk about this in a minute, would be about $20 million a year over about 15 years. That's real money, right? Out of the state treasury. But the impact would be close to $900 million a year in new economic output, and there would be a $1.5 million one-time construction impact. These are not my numbers. I handed the data over, it was handed back to me, it's Extension Service, they tend to do conservative analysis because they have to protect their reputation, they're not a consulting shop selling you a new Viking stadium, they are, they're the university. So we feel pretty comfortable with this, we think you could actually get bigger impact after the incentive actually ends, the industry would continue to grow because you will have built your base. You will have commercialized some of the technology, and so you could have even bigger impact. So what do we want to do? So 2013 was our first year at the legislature. We wanted to tackle early stage, pilot stage development. We've got great technology coming out of the lab. How do we get them up to pilot stage? So we did some work with a group called the Next Gen Board to make sure that renewable chemicals qualify. This was our sort of modest, we just formed a coalition, let's see what we can get done our first year. We were able to help add renewable chemicals to a $2.5 million grant fund, and 3 of our member companies got grants out of it. It's going to help some companies grow in Minnesota. It helped a couple companies build pilot scale plants. So that had an impact. It's not enough, though. What we need as a state is commercial scale production. And we're competing with a lot of jurisdictions that are really going after this stuff. And that's why you had NatureWorks, Minnesota-based company, build a plant in Thailand. That's why you had BioAmber, another Minnesota company, build in Sarnia, Ontario. Other than the competitive part, I mean, I kind of hate this whole, industry blackmail thing, too. Like, well, we have to pay you because someone else is paying you more. But that's the world we live in. That's the fact, we can't get Thailand to eliminate their incentives. But I think there's also a very good public policy rationale for providing incentives for new technology. I think if you look at the history of a whole variety of renewable energy technologies, they got a lot of public support in the early stage. This is the early stage for a lot of these things. I think there's a good justification for supporting them. What we want to avoid is giving a big slug of money up front and having a project fail. Everybody asks us about Solyndra, which we could talk on at length about. But I don't even want to have that conversation, frankly. What we're doing, though, with this policy is there's no money up front. It's a production-based incentive. It's a performance-based incentive. If you can convince investors that you've got good technology and they should invest in your plant and you get it built, you get an incentive on the tail end once you're actually producing. This was the same principle. We just talked about this last night with the wind production tax credit. It's performance-based. It's not an upfront deal. It's not, here's $1 million to build a wind turbine and good luck. It's, if you get the thing built, you're going to reward on the other end. So we like that. It rewards success. The state is really guaranteed to have that economic benefit because the facility will be built, it will be operating, it will be producing material or purchasing material. this would make, if we pass this, and so far it's in the governor's budget, we're going to be trying to pass it next session, Minnesota would be the best place in the world, hands down, to do these projects. We would see a lot of new activity. This, some of our bill authors, really proud to have a bipartisan bill, Democrats and Republicans, forestry legislators, agricultural legislators, metro legislators. So that's sort of the new technology side. That's mostly advanced biofuels and renewable chemicals. These are things where it's a little tough to get mainstream investors to put money into it. There's a justification for public support to try to commercialize this new technology that's in the public interest. But there are a number of things that I would call proven technology that still maybe are proven elsewhere, so investors aren't quite comfortable with it. Really thinking about anaerobic digestion projects, which, you know, if you go to Sweden or Germany, they're all over the place, but we don't have as many here. So the technology's there. The economics are good. On the anaerobic digestion side, I could list off 7 projects that are, you know, just about financed, right? They're just about there. The economics look pretty good, but they're just not quite over the edge, right? So what, and the other part of that is these kind of institutional biomass heating projects. Put in a biomass boiler at the hospital, at the community college. Good proven technology, just not, for various reasons, hard to get investment in it. We want to create a gap loan program. You'd have to get a lot of other investment in place. This could get you the next $1 to $2 million to get you over the edge and make the project happen. You'd put this in the hands of a competent investor, you know, kind of thinking about maybe the St. Paul Port Authority or something like that. People who are good at doing due diligence for projects. But I think we could get, you know, for a $30-40 million fund, we might get 20 projects out of it. And significantly more than that dollar amount in total investment. We also like the idea, we haven't totally agreed on how this would run yet, but how about some kind of biomass stove rebate program? You require really good technology, the most modern technology, low-emitting technology, focus on parts of the state served by propane. Not exclusively, but that's where the need is. And the state, you know, there's a big process looking for what in the world do we do about the propane crisis so it doesn't happen again. This is one of the things we could do. Other states have done programs like this that were wildly popular and had a lot of impact. So that's my spiel. I'm happy to take any questions. Yeah, John.
Would you have any difficulty eliminating the incentives for only Minnesota-based companies? Is there some exchanges you could love?
Yeah. Well, that's a discussion that the group has had. I think that we would miss some companies that we might want to have in the state by doing that. I mean, I think, for example, there is not a homegrown Minnesota-based cellulosic ethanol plant company. You know, Poet is a big one. They're in Sioux Falls. They're based in Sioux Falls. DuPont, you know, they're not going to move their headquarters to Minnesota because of our little incentive program. So I think we would miss out on the opportunity to retrofit every ethanol plant in the state with the opportunity to do cellulosic ethanol as a bolt-on. I think there's other examples like that. You could think about a preference, and we've talked about it. We've decided not to go down that road, at least in our recommendations. Of requiring that headquarters be in the state. You know, the other thing you could get is if you require headquarters in the state, well, they just set up a sham company in your state. Oh, absolutely, yes. Absolutely, yes. The facility would need to be in the state, and the materials would need to come from the state as well. Yep?
But you're not restricted by securities exchange or anything?
Not that I'm aware of. Yeah?
I have two questions. Is your organization thinking about the upcoming surplus of fuel in terms of ash trees that are going to be available in this state? Millions upon millions
yep.
of trees. And secondly, is the industry equipped to use with the renewable bio less water mm-hmm. than the ethanol industry does, which is consuming mass amounts of water, which is desperately needed in some dry parts of the state.
Yeah, it depends on your technology. I think in general, they're going to use less water. Even ethanol uses a lot. Corn ethanol uses a lot less water than it used to. But, you know, we have some ethanol plants in places that if they had it to do over again, they wouldn't put them there. I think that the DNR has really kind of tightened their rules on how projects like this get permitted. And they're really focusing a lot more on water availability because it's becoming an issue in parts of the state like southwestern Minnesota. You know, groundwater availability is a big issue. So, sort of a rambling around the question. I think it depends on the technology, but I also am fairly confident in the ability of our permitting system to avoid putting the wrong plant in the wrong place.
And the ash trees?
Oh, ash trees. We've got counties in Minnesota with more than 30% ash. It's a huge opportunity. And that damaged ash wood can't be used in the traditional forest products industry. So if you create energy markets, it might be the only thing that you could do with it. So it's a big opportunity, definitely. And it creates the ability to manage that stuff and instead of just leaving it dead out in the woods and creating a fire risk. If you can't use it for anything, where is the motivation for a logger to go out and remove it, right? So. Yeah, but you know the process of pelletizing that wood would kill the bugs in it, and then you could transport the pellets. So.
Are you getting any kind of support or interest from the utilities? Like I know Excel had the turkey manure plant. And are you interested in all of this?
We've had a lot of interest from Minnesota Power because they're a big part of the economic scene up in northeastern Minnesota, and they're just as worried as everybody else is about the decline of the forest products industry. I mean, it's because they're just tied in with all those communities up there. So they're very interested in what we're doing. Great River Energy has also been engaged. Neither of those companies have joined, but I wouldn't be surprised if one or both of them did. I mean, Great River, they actually own a couple of ethanol plants in North Dakota, and they service a lot of ethanol plants in rural Minnesota, or at least their distribution co-ops do. So I think there's a lot of interest. You know, and again, you know, the co-op model, they're owned by their members, they want their members to do well. This is a rural economic development opportunity. So it benefits them. Yeah?
I have a question about the utilities and rebate financing. So if you're going to do a rebate financing, the traditional way is going through utilities.
You know,
yep. So much of it involves that. Are you looking at those same locations for the...
Yeah. Yeah, well, the in terms of the stove rebate program...
or gas, or
yeah.
The
I think Department of Ag is who we hope will have the production-based incentive. Because they ran a program called the Ethanol Producer Payment Program, which was similar. I mean, it was for a different thing, but it's a similar in how it's administered. And in terms of a loan program, a gap loan program, I don't know where that will end up. We're a little earlier in our discussions with that. And same thing with like a stove rebate program. I would imagine it would be a state agency that would run a stove rebate program. That happened. Yeah.
What are the different federal initiatives that have been set up in the 80s on stoves, blueberry stoves?
There's a lot of models out there for how to do it. The technology is a lot better now, though.
Are you guys involved with the plant out at U of M Morris and, corn cobs?
They're gasifier. I know them. That's the kind of thing that we would hopefully get more of. I mean, I think our program would help make that more attractive to replicate. Yeah, John?
What are your prospects for success in 2015?
Great. I feel great about it.
I guess you've been
put on, we said that the energy use, because that's quite often what I hear when I talk about ethanol, mm-hmm. how much gas, how much fuel it takes to make, but that's whether or not that's actually, that's what everybody is
right.
going around, like your Thanksgiving dinner, your cocktail party, whatever.
Yep, is. Absolutely.
So what's a good one if you're lying or two?
Well, this program is not about doing any more corn ethanol.
Okay.
Period.
Sure.
You know, a corn ethanol plant would not qualify for any of the incentives in this program.
Okay.
I personally think corn ethanol it has its pros and cons, but one thing that you can say for it is it's a nice foundation that we can build on. We can upgrade, we can reinvest in those plants, we can bolt on biomass-powered ethanol to those plants, make them more efficient in the process. You know, they've already got relationships with farmers that might, you know, are growing corn from them now, but might be able to provide them with switchgrass in the future. They have the marketing relationships to sell the fuel. So it's a nice foundation to build on. But I don't think anyone's really talking about building any more corn ethanol.
Is Iowa ahead of us on this? I mean, a few years ago, I've heard about all kinds of things happening down there.
Yep. There, I would say Iowa, I mean, Iowa's ahead of us. They, Governor Culver supported the creation of a program called the Iowa Power Fund, which gave some big grants away, and that's why there are three, actually, cellulosic ethanol plants coming online this year in Iowa. That dates way back to the Culver administration. That's why they chose Iowa. Some of those plants, I can tell you, were looking at Minnesota at the time.
Can you say about DuPont and Procter & Gamble announcing that they're going to put cellulosic ethanol in their detergents? Is that one of those same lines? Do you know if it's coming from those cellulosic plants?
I know more about that than you do. I think I just read the press release too. But I mean, it's just an interesting example of how you can produce other things other than fuel. Although they're just, all it is ethanol, right?
Yeah.
They actually use ethanol as a solvent in their detergent or a blending agent or something. Yeah.
Do we have some landfill projects going on? I remember years ago, Flying Cloud had one.
Mm-hmm.
Are there still some projects going on?
There are a few in the state. You know, in another slide deck, I have a map of where they are. But yeah, we do have a few landfill gas projects. We do have a few digesters at wastewater treatment plants. We have a few on-farm systems. Yeah.
In the Holland Shield Farm, is that still?
It's a cool project. Yeah. It's a cool project. They're very dedicated, and they have certainly had their share of technical difficulties with that project, which I think makes it a little hard to replicate. You know, unless you're a true believer and willing to devote a ton of time to it. But I think there's other models that work very well.
Isn't it, how big are they? How much? Isn't it that they were trying to stick below the net metering rates and thus had to downsize?
So you missed the whole presentation, Eric.
Yes, so. Sorry.
Well, so here's kind of our mantra on anaerobic digestion. The problem with on-farm projects, and I think people should feel free to do them, there's nothing wrong with an on-farm project, but they have a few strikes against them that make them more difficult to implement. One of them is they're very small scale, so that obviously you don't benefit from economics of scale. Your per unit production cost for the gas is low, and then you're not big enough to justify the cost to do gas cleanup and remove, you know, things like hydrogen sulfide from the gas, and you're producing electricity, which is your lowest value product from biogas. So you end up producing very expensive electricity. And then maybe your rural co-op doesn't feel like buying very expensive electricity, but they kind of want to support you because you're a co-op member and it puts them in a bind. Anyway, what we like is larger scale projects that put together resources from multiple things, not just one little farm. You aggregate, you get up to bigger scale, your economics are better. And then you do something other than producing electricity. You compress gas to make vehicle fuel. You clean up the gas and inject it into the natural gas grid. There's even actually some proposals to make high-value chemicals out of the methane, too. So I think the economics to those approaches can be more favorable. Well, we're right on time. It's 7 exactly.
All right, good job. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much.